ACHS, we are four acts into the story of the Bible, and some people live and act as if the last part of the story, Jesus dying on the cross, is the end of the story, but it's not the end of the story at all. We still actually have two acts to go. Let's go back and look at some verses from Matthew 9. Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom, and healing every sickness and disease. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field." Do you see it? Do you get it? CHS, we can't be satisfied with our own little community. We can't be satisfied with that anymore. In this part of the story, we learn that we are not here for us. We are here for them. Jesus was saying, right now, we're in the middle of sheep without a shepherd. People are alone, afraid, confused, harassed, helpless, hell-bound, but there could be a harvest. We could see a harvest of redeemed humanity that would bring joy to heaven and bring heaven to earth. We could see a harvest of reconciliation that could deliver people from all the hatred and violence that is still going on in our world. But guys, don't miss this. If the workers are not available, the harvest will be lost. So what should we do? Jesus says, pray, pray, pray that the Lord of the harvest, because it's his harvest. God is the one who's at work in human lives. Pray that the Lord of the harvest will send out. Then Jesus chooses a very interesting word. Will send out workers. Not experts, not professionals, not spectators, not consumers, just this very humble word, workers. Now, what does a worker do? Well, a worker works. Jesus had a lot to say about this. He said, "I have to be about the work my Father sent for me to do." He says in John 9, "As long as it is day, we must do the work of him who sent me." It's simple work. Anybody can do this. Anybody can listen and notice. Anybody can encourage, care, share, give, serve, come alongside, witness, in love. Jesus said to his friends, pray. Guys, you have to pray that God will send out workers, spiritual workers, kingdom workers, because my heart is breaking and the human race is like sheep without a shepherd. You have to pray. Jesus's 12 disciples prayed, God, send out workers. In the very next verse, Matthew 10 verse 1, God has Jesus send out workers. And guess who God had Jesus send out? Jesus sent out the very people who prayed, God send out workers, his 12 disciples. Now that's a real dangerous prayer to pray. Now this is crucial. Jesus had a mission. It was his idea. He started it. He went on it. He was doing it because his heart was broken at the shape of our world. But Jesus had a mission. And one day, he invited some people to join with him in it. Jesus did not start a church and then give it a mission. Jesus started a mission and then gave it a church. Sometimes people forget the order. They think the church is a place that exists just because, but maybe they have a missions department, or maybe they send out a few people to do some good things. Maybe they go to Haiti or the DR, Houston, Kensington. But guys, the order matters. Jesus didn't start a church and give it a mission. He went on a mission and then he invited a church. We're invited to join the mission of Jesus. That's why we are here. That's why Calvary Church exists. Here's what can happen over time. David Platt, who's a pastor, writes about a ship that was built 60 years ago to be the greatest troop carrier in the US naval history. It was called the SS United States. It was designed to carry 15,000 troops faster and farther without having to stop for fuel or supplies than any other ship in military history. The only thing was, it never carried troops. It was such a remarkable ship that it got turned into a luxury liner for celebrities and heads of state. It contained 600 staterooms, 4 dining salons, 3 bars, 2 theaters, and the comfort of being the world's first fully air-conditioned passenger ship for wealthy patrons who wanted to enjoy first-class service. It was designed to be a troop carrier, to have a mission, but it got turned into a luxury liner for consumers. It's a bad thing when that happens to a church. Really bad. We have a mission. The church is just a troop carrier. We are not here for ourselves. What if Jesus was here? What if he was with me? What if he was with you every day? Because he is. What if he walked around your school? What if he was at your work? What if he walked around your neighborhood? What if we were with him, seeing what he sees and feeling what he feels? Do you think Jesus would look around and say, mission accomplished? I don't think he would. I think he would see more spiritual confusion than ever. I think he'd see more people feeling alone, feeling unloved. I think he'd see addictions on the rise. I think he'd see people struggling with all sorts of things, like shame, confusion, selfishness, people looking every direction to find significance and love, and all kinds of pain connected to what society says is beauty and significance. I think he'd see people enslaved by pornography. I think he'd see hidden racism all over the place. I think he'd see inequality. I think he'd see anxious high school seniors who are terrified they won't get into the school they want, or worse yet, never figure out what exactly they are supposed to do for the rest of their lives. He'd see people who are looking for their identity and who they love or what they can do or who they're surrounded by. I think he'd see a lot of fear. Fear of aging, or fear of failure, or maybe fear of not having enough money, or maybe for some of us, fear of death. But then he'd see the church. He'd see this community of people who know God, who say we know God, who know the grace of being forgiven and being loved, and he'd see a community that has been given the gift of the Holy Spirit to guide us, to give us hope and wisdom from the scriptures. Then I think Jesus would say, do you see what I see? Do you feel what I feel? Do you know we're not just here for us? God has some work for us to do. He's looking for some people who will work with him to restore and repair, redeem and reconcile. Wherever you find yourself tomorrow, God has some repairing and restoring to do there. There are things broken and fractured and splintered all around us. Families, relationships, addictions, priorities. Ask God to give you eyes to see the fractures and the wounds that alienation brings, and then work with them to restore and renew the things that are broken. Does that sound a little impossible? Maybe a lot impossible? Well, Acts 1:8 says this: you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. You are here. You have received power. Now go and do the work. Go and join the mission.